interesting things that crop up throughout the pages of the scriptures that we'll look at here in a moment. But there was a French writer that came to the United States back in 1831. His name was Alexis de Tocqueville. And he said this about his journeys through America. He said, "I sought for the greatness of the United States in her commodious harbors, her ample rivers, her fertile fields, and boundless forests. And it was not there. I sought for it in her rich mines, her vast world commerce, her public school system, and in her institutions of higher learning. And it was not there. I looked for it in her democratic Congress and her matchless constitution, and it was not there. Not until I went into the churches of America and heard her pulpits flame with righteousness did I understand the secret of her genius and power. America is great because America is good. And if America ceases to be good, America will cease to be great." A very interesting observation given by this French writer. And if you're like me today, I'm greatly troubled by the trends occurring in this nation. Many here today, I think you could look back to when you grew up and you look at things today and say, things are vastly different, aren't they? Vastly different. In fact, some would say we're better off now today, but I would have to maybe disagree with that a little bit, as our growing problems, both internationally and domestically, really tell us otherwise. But can I say here today, there is hope. There is hope, and that's what we want to focus on more than anything else today, is that there is hope if the people of our nation will look back to the roots and discover what made our nation great. And those roots are firmly attached to God and His Word. He's got some help for our nation. I believe it will take heed to it. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, we'll pick it up in verse 12 and read through verse 14 today. The Bible says, "And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself for a house of sacrifice. If I shut up heaven and there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land." Today I'd like to talk about God's help for our nation. God's help for our nation. Heavenly Father, we thank you for a time we can come and reflect on your goodness to our country. I pray that as we go through some of these things here today, that you would speak to our hearts. Lord, give us a resolve to help our nation and then be a part of restoring some of its greatness and be part of helping our posterity, O God, to have the freedoms in which we enjoy it today. Thank you, Father, for giving us this nation. Father, help us preserve it by your guiding grace. Thank you for this day. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, there are many today that grow up really unaware of our nation's roots connected to the scriptures, the Bible itself. It's not something that's promoted very heavily anymore in our education system. In fact, it appears that it's quite frowned upon. I'm talking about some of the things that I'm going to share with you today. In fact, sometimes I wonder if some churches don't even seem to be addressing the subject, maybe as much as we should. But if a person takes a look around, it's not hard to see God's, or the influence of God's Word in the early days of our nation. Several of our founders and political leaders, since our nation was founded, acknowledged the direct connection between our nation and the tenets of Scripture. You know, Benjamin Franklin once said, this was during the Constitutional Congress, when they were writing the Constitution up, he said, "God governs in the affairs of men. And if a sparrow cannot fall to the ground without his notice, is it probable that an empire can rise without his aid?" They were having problems writing the Constitution initially. They called for some days of prayer and fasting. It was after that prayer and fasting, the seeking of God, the God of heaven, that they came up with this document we know to be today, the Constitution of the United States of America. Thomas Jefferson, our third president, he said, "God who gave us life gave us liberty. And can the liberties of a nation be thought secure when we have removed their only firm basis, a conviction in the minds of the people that these liberties are a gift from God, that they are not to be violated but with His wrath, Indeed, I tremble for my country when I reflect that God is just, and that his justice cannot sleep forever. So our second president, John Adams, said this: the general principles upon which the fathers, the founding fathers, that is, achieved independence were the general principles of Christianity. I will avow that I believe, and now believe, that those general principles of Christianity are as eternal and immutable as the existence and attributes of God. John Quincy Adams, another president of ours, the highest glory of the American Revolution was this: that it connected in one indissoluble bond the principles of civil government with the principles of Christianity. I wonder how many people know this stuff. Maybe this is the first time you've ever seen any of these things. Patrick Henry, revolutionist, I think many of you are familiar with this phrase, give me liberty or give me death, he said this: it cannot be emphasized too strongly or too often that this great nation was founded not by religionists, but by Christians. Not on religions, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ. For this very reason, notice, peoples of other faiths have been afforded asylum, prosperity, and freedom of worship here. Ronald Reagan, our 40th president, said this: to preserve our blessed land, we must look to God. It is time to realize that we need God more than he needs us. We also have his promise that we could take to heart with regard to our country, but that if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sin and will heal their land. He quotes our text today. Daniel Webster, another man, he spent roughly 40 years in American politics. He said, finally, let us not forget the religious character of our origin. Our fathers were brought hither by their high veneration for the Christian religion. Wow. For some people in our nation, that would give them a lot of heartburn. But it's true. And this is just a skimming off the top. The multitude of quotes, the multitude of things that were said by many of our founders and many of our presidents and many of our senators and other prominent individuals within this nation. They exist all over the place. And all these things communicate our nation's history, in our nation's history, that was based on the moral precepts found in Scripture. All over Washington, D.C., and other prominent places in our nation's history, we find references to God. I've had the privilege of standing on the floor of the House of Representatives there on Capitol Hill a couple times. And if you see a picture of where the Speaker of the House sits, and usually the place where the President speaks when he does the State of the Union address, you see above that arc there, that stage area there, the phrase, "In God we trust." In the Washington Monument, which is around 555 feet tall there in the city, there's a copper cap on the top of that thing, and there's a little Latin inscription on top of that that faces the east as the sun rises. It says, "Laus Deus," which means "Praise be to God." I've been in the Capitol Rotunda there, and if you've ever been in that Capitol Rotunda, you know that within it there's these large paintings all around the wall depicting the nation's history, one of which is called The Embarkation of the Pilgrims by Robert Weir. It was painted around 1843. It depicts the deck of the ship Speedwell as it departed for the New World. In the picture, you see the pilgrims are observing a day of fasting and prayer led by William Brewster, who is holding a Bible. And if you go up to the picture, the Bible says very plainly, "The New Testament of the Lord Jesus Christ," or something on that lines. And you see that there was another man there by the name of John Robertson, a pastor, who was leading in that. And there's so many different references and so many different things you see sprinkled throughout our country that say that God was heavily involved in the establishment of it, that he has had a significant part of our nation's history. And I believe he can be part of our nation's future. In fact, I believe that we need him to be. I believe we need him to be more than ever. First off, let's talk about the proliferating problems. I don't want to dwell on this a whole lot, but we can't ignore the problems. You know, as we read news stories and hear about a variety of issues we are constantly facing, we see really the multiplication of problems in our nation. Problems that seem with every passing day to get more complex, more expensive, and the solutions seem to be more and more evasive. Today we have a $20 trillion debt. We can't even begin to wrap our minds around $20 trillion. I can't even wrap my mind around $1 trillion, much less $20 trillion. It does not appear that it's going to get any smaller anytime sooner. The Bible has a principle. It says in Proverbs 22:7, the rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the lender. Servant to the lender. Who are we becoming the servant to in this nation? Of course, there's the growing violence nature of our society. I think some of you grew up in a time when you went to the school and you never thought about a buddy or a classmate pulling a trigger and mowing down your other classmates, but yet we have that today. In fact, even in recent days, we've had political shootings now. You know, there's always been disagreement on Capitol Hill, but now it's getting to the place where people are advocating violence against our political leaders. I don't care what side of the aisle you're on. Ew, that's not to be happening. But it is. And workplace violence attacks and things like that. You may just say on the side, it's not the gun's fault. Man has been killing man well before there was ever gunpowder. The issues in London that have happened in the recent weeks prove that. We have family units today that are crumbling apart. Mom and dad can't get along. Mom and dad aren't investing in the kids. Kids aren't interested in the parents. People splitting up. There's a lot of emotional trauma that takes place when that happens in the life of the child and in the lives of the parents. It affects so much. We have tensions that arise between various people groups within our nation. We have the rise of terrorism. And that's just domestically. What about internationally? We have growing threats from a multitude of nations. Namely, I think most of us are familiar with North Korea. I've been on the DMZ, the demilitarized zone between North and South Korea. I've talked to defectors from North Korea before. And some of the things that they explain that goes on. I've done some research on the country, and it is not a pretty situation over there with a very hostile leader who has a triple trigger, could launch a nuclear weapon. And of course, there's lots of concern over on the Korean Peninsula as a result of that. The country of Russia, in recent days, has not had any problem doing provocative actions against our military, making you wonder what their real intention is. Of course, we could talk about the country of Iran, the number one country in the world of state-sponsored terrorism. They're not necessarily our friend. And they've made that very clear. We have problems in places today in the Middle East, particularly in Syria, and Afghanistan, and Iraq, and a bunch of different places that, whether or not they're necessarily a specific threat to us, we are involved in it in some regards. Needless to say, problems are proliferating all over the place that we are involved with. And nobody really has the complete answer of how to solve them, do they? If you know anything about the history of the nation of Israel and how it's recorded in the Bible, there were times in Israel's history where national problems would mount. There would be invasions that would take place against the country. There would be droughts, there would be famines, there would be things that would just, it would begin to really get a hold of the hearts of the people at that time. And they were always in connection, those things happening, with how well the country was obeying and practicing the precepts of God. Or if they weren't. It was always connected to that, their obedience to the Word of God. Our text here is God's response to a prayer given by one of the Israel's kings, their most predominant king. His name was Solomon. At the dedication of the house of God in those days, it was the Jewish temple that sat on the Temple Mount. The Temple Mount still exists today. If you ever see a picture of Jerusalem, it is that place where that golden mosque, or it's actually not a mosque, it's a it's a shrine. But that golden dome that sits on that temple mount, it's the most priceless piece of property on the planet. More blood will be shed for that piece of property than any place else in the world. And that's where the Jewish temple sat, the first one. It was at the dedication of that glorious building that you can read about in the Old Testament that Solomon offers these prayers to God as the leader of that nation. He offers prayers asking for God's mercy when the country strayed from God. If you just flip back to 2 Chronicles 6, verse 26, this is part of the prayer. We won't read the whole thing for the sake of time, but notice the language of Solomon. He says, when the heaven is shut up and there is no rain, because they have sinned against thee, yet if they pray toward this place and confess thy name and turn from their sin when thou dost afflict them, then hear thou from heaven and forgive the sin of thy servants and of thy people Israel, when thou hast taught them the good way wherein they should walk, and send rain upon thy land, which thou hast given unto thy people for an inheritance. If there be dearth in the land, if there be pestilence, if there be blasting or mildew or locusts or caterpillars, if their enemies besiege them in the cities of their land, whatsoever sore or whatsoever sickness there be, then what prayer or what supplication soever shall be made of any man or all thy people Israel, when every one shall know his own sore and his own grief, and shall spread forth his hands in this house, then hear thou from heaven and thy dwelling place, and forgive, and render unto every man according unto all his ways, whose heart thou knowest, for thou only knowest the hearts of the children of men, that they may fear thee to walk in thy ways so long as I live in the land which thou gavest unto thy fathers. What he's saying here is this: when there's problems that arise, whether we're talking about health-related, famines, enemy armies coming in and besieging or trying to take down cities, he's saying, if the people would begin to seek thy face in your house, the house of God in those days, in the temple, he's asking God, God, will you hear their prayer? Will you hear their prayer? Will you respond to them? Will you help them if they repent of their ways, if they turn from their sin, if they get right with you, and they pray to you, God, will you hear that prayer? Have mercy on it, on the people here, when those things happen. And in our text, God responds to that prayer by saying that He will hear. He will hear. Verse 13 of our text, it says, if I shut up heaven that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people. In other words, if there's problems that propagate, I will hear. Now, why would God send problems? Allow those problems to, again, because of the sins of the people. The sins of the people. You know, our problems in our nation, if you really went back to the root of it, are really linked to some sin. It's what it is. The sins of pride, selfishness, anger, immorality, covetousness, rebellion, ungratefulness, lying, cheating, stealing. That's just made of fear. The Bible says in Proverbs 14:34, righteousness, the opposite of all those things we just mentioned, exalted or promotes a nation. But sin is a reproach or a pulling down of many to any people. Sin never blesses us, it always curses us. And God doesn't really need to step in a whole lot to do much, because it's just the natural consequences of sin in this world. The only way to solve the sin problem, of course, is to acknowledge it and turn from it. The word the Bible uses is the word repent. Repent. We can't solve a problem if we constantly insist on committing the same acts that happen. We've got to consider that today. But secondly, let's talk about the prayerful people. The prayerful people. Where is this repentance supposed to start? Now, the first thing a lot of people say is, let's start pointing at our government. The White House, Capitol Hill, the Supreme Court, the state capitals, our city council chambers. That's where it needs to start. Well, I'm going to break the news to you. Guess what? It's not going to start in those places. The effects of where it starts will, however, influence those places. I believe verse 14 tells us where it's to start. says that my people, which are called by my name, my people, called by my name. Who's he talking about? God's people. God's people. It's people who have become God's people. 1 Peter 2:10 mentions this, which in time past were, notice, not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. It's interesting to note that there's a distinction. There's a people that's not God's people, and then there's a people that are God's people. And that the people that were God's people, all of a sudden, in Peter's epistle here, have become God's people. How did this happen? How did this happen? Peter addresses it in an earlier chapter. Born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. Peter's writing to people who have been born again. Born again. That's who he's addressing within context. And they have become the people of God. When somebody is born again, they become part of God's people. Again, notice it's not when we're baptized, or when we're confirmed, or when we join the church. But we must have a time in our lives when we've been born again. In fact, that's what Jesus said. John chapter 3 and verse 3, speaking to a very devout religious man by the name Nicodemus, he said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So what does that mean? Maybe you've heard that term before, and you're like, that sounds so foreign. Or what's it talking about? To be born again, you must come to realize the gravity of your own personal sin. That our sins are an offense to God, because he is a thrice holy God. He is perfectly holy. Our sins go contrary to his character. As a result, God must judge our sin. And our sin condemns us. But if we, with a heart of contrition, recognize that, you know what? I recognize that I've done wrong. That I've sinned against God. We can seek God's forgiveness if we're willing to turn from those sins, in other words, repent. And by faith, no longer trust ourselves to get ourselves to heaven by our good works, but trust Jesus Christ alone with the blood he shed upon Calvary's cross. And that, when that happens, when we're willing to do that, we can become born again. Acts 20, verse 21 talks about these two things of repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. The two tenets of salvation. Of being born again. And the day a person is willing to just simply turn from their sin and place faith solely in Jesus Christ, nothing else, is the day that they are born again. Or another term, the Bible uses the word saved. Romans 10:13 says, For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord with the heart attitude of repentance and faith shall be saved. On April 4th of 1999, I realized I was lost. That my sin was condemning me forever. That if I had died that day, I'd go to hell. And then I realized what Jesus did for me. And I trusted him in that moment. I said, Lord, I don't want to sin against you anymore. I know I've offended you with the way I've lived my life, but I don't want to do that anymore. And I trusted him that day. And from that day forward, God's given me assurance that he's forgiven my sin, past, present, and future. By the day I die, I'll be with him in heaven. Not because I've earned it, but I deserve it, not because I'm a pastor. It's solely what he has done for me. And there are many here today that can testify the same thing. At the time that you were born again, and that day you became part of God's people. But even God's people sometimes backslide from God, don't they? They get away from God. They allow the world, and they allow the influences of the flesh to take them away from God. And in our text, God tells Solomon that if his people would get right, would pray, would seek his face, he would respond. That's what it says here. If my people, which are called by my name, shall, notice, humble themselves. You know, when we admit when we're wrong, that's an act of humility, isn't it? None of us like to admit. I don't like admitting when I'm wrong. But when we do, that's an act of humility. And then the next thing is pray. Speak to God. talk to him. And of course, seek his face. In other words, that he would be the priority of our life, not ourselves. And notice the next word, turn from their wicked ways. In other words, the sins that they've committed. As a result, God says, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Now, why does God start with his people? I mean, why does he start with, or the problem are, quote unquote? The reason is because God's people should know better. They should know better. They do know better and should know better. We can't blame our problems on people who do not know God as much as we need to start doing the inventory of our personal hearts. 1 Peter 4:17 says, "For the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God." That's what God's people are. And if it first began at us, what shall the end of them that obey not the gospel be? It starts with God's people taking an inventory of their part and coming clean with God. As go the churches, so goes the nation. Because the church is supposed to be the moral standard or communicate the moral standards of God. And that's what Alexis de Tocqueville recognized. The churches were cross-denominational lines at that time particularly. Communicated a righteousness that God is holy and God is just and that we need to live according to his ways and his commands. And all over our country, we have postings of the Ten Commandments that tell us how to reverence God and respect our fellow man. So I don't understand why we're taking them down. You think about it. Thou shalt not steal. That's a good thing. Right? Thou shalt not lie. I'm sure a lot of teachers would love to see their students not steal a lie. It's not helping our cause. Those things are righteous. Those things we think, yeah, that's a no-brainer, but it's not being communicated anymore. As go the churches, so go the nation. Why? Because the churches are to be the pillar and ground of the truth. What's the truth? Well, God's truth. 1 Timothy 3:15, "But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth." In other words, it's the place where people should be able to come and find out what God says. What God says. That's what it's supposed to be. And maybe it's churches today that need to get right and see God's face. And I believe when they do, the nation will follow because God always starts with his people. Again, God's people should know better. God's people should know where the peace to be the priority. God's people should know what the Bible says about certain things. But even today in churches, that's not being promoted, is it? Sometimes the average church today is almost becoming an entertainment social club. Doesn't look any different than what you can take place up at the Target Center. Is that helping us? Well, that's all you reach the young people. Can I say this? Our young people need principle, not playtime. Our young people need equipping, not entertainment. Our young people need to learn righteousness, not ridiculousness. They need to learn responsibility, not recklessness. They need guidance, not goofiness. They need a worthy cause, not worldliness. Boy, it would transform our schools. It would transform a lot if our young people learned that. Instead of having to entertain them to death just to keep their attention. If we want hope for our nation, it'll take God's people getting right, taking inventory of their own heart, seeking God once again. That's where it's going to start. It's not going to start at the White House. It's not going to start at the Capitol Hill. I'm all for electing the best officials we can with good character and principled ones. But you know what? Even they, I've spoke to members of Congress on a few occasions here. I remember one in particular from this state. This person said that, you know what, our solution is not here. You know, I was talking in her office, and she said that the solution is what you're talking about, or we were visiting the elected officials and presenting this to tokens of our nation's history that are biblically rooted. And she said that the solution is not here on Capitol Hill. It's back home with you guys. to understand and proclaim the truths of God's word. We need God because He's the only one who can get us out of the jams we're in. Ever been in a personal jam? I've been in several. But I've also seen God work through those jams and getting out of them and bless in the ways that never saw possible. If that can happen on an individual level, how much more could it happen on a national level? But it starts with God's people. It starts with God's people. We need the prayerful people. Then we see, thirdly and finally, the powerful hope of David. When God's people get right, it sets course for God's intervention. That's what verse 14 concludes with. When God's people humble themselves, pray, seek His face, turn from their wicked ways, notice then, the word then, it transitions. When that happens, this is what's going to happen. If, there's the Bible is full of if-then statements. If this takes place, then this is going to happen. If it doesn't, this won't. But if the admonition has taken place in the first half of the verse, then God says, will I hear? Will I hear from heaven? And will forgive their sin and will heal their land. When God's people get right, it sets course for God's intervention. Because God is not interested, or doesn't desire, if you will, for us to experience pain and judgment and things like that. God is actually quite merciful. I don't think we really understand. Sometimes that mercy is abused. But He's very merciful. That's a great verse in Micah 7:18. It said, the Old Testament minor prophet. He said, who is a God like unto thee that pardoneth iniquity or sin and passeth by the transgression of the remnant of his heritage? He retaineth not his anger forever because, next phrase, he delighteth in mercy. God's very merciful. He's very merciful. He delights. Whenever He gets a chance to show mercy, that's something that He just enjoys. He desires to do that. He wants people. He just has no problem forgiving people. But the thing is, He wants people to acknowledge. Yeah, I'm wrong. God says, that's all I want. And He will pardon sin. Because He desires so much so to show mercy. If people humbly acknowledge their sin, God will graciously forgive. And as a result, respond to the prayers of His people. He will respond. And that's what He promises here. I will forgive their sin. And I will heal their land. I will heal them. The Bible is loaded with stories in which this has taken place in the Old Testament, particularly, where God stepped into the nation's history, and they weren't doing right, but then they began to turn their eyes back to God, began to seek Him again, and God wrought great things, restored them, encouraged them, and blessed them once again. And sometimes some of those stories in the Old Testament there, it's incredible. Their backs were against the wall. I mean, things were not looking good. I mean, it came down to the wire. But then God reversed it. Why? Because there's nothing too hard for God. Jeremiah 32:7 is a great verse. Oh, Lord God, the prophet Jeremiah says, behold, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power and stretched out arm, and there is nothing too hard for thee. Think about something in your life today you think is too hard. It's not too hard for God at all. How do we know? Well, it says right here in this verse, thou hast made the heaven and the earth. The creation itself speaks that God can do anything. I don't know if you've ever seen pictures from the Hubble Space Telescope. And some of the things are it's just astronomical how far they are, how vast this universe is, and how far that telescope has looked out. I think there's a picture they have where they focus on a spot out in the universe about the size of the grain of sand. They did it for about 10 days with that telescope, and the picture came back, and they showed what looks like stars, but they are actually galaxies with billions of stars in them. In fact, scientists estimate the known universe, at least what we know, to be 91 billion light years in diameter. We can't get our minds around that, can we? A light year is the distance light travels in a year. I believe light travels at a distance of 130,000 miles per second, I think. Something like that. That's how vast and large this universe is. And the Bible opens up by saying, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. When we see what God has done in the creation itself, we can look into our little problems here, and they don't look little, do they? But compared to what God's already done, they are little. The one who threw the stars in their sockets and upholds everything by the word of his power can certainly work and help us through the issues our nation is facing. But the thing is, it's God's people that have to live for him. It's God's people that have to get serious with him. Be more serious than some of the things that maybe we put in ahead of him. And I believe that we can make a real difference, even in this generation. There was a time before the Second Great Awakening, after the American Revolution, where they said that the churches were about to close under, that they were going to be a thing of the past. Maybe you've heard of the writer Thomas Paine, who's a vehement atheist who preached reason, if you will. And there was a great movement of God called the Second Great Awakening. One of the prominent figures was a guy by the name of Finney. Preacher. It made a difference in the country, and morality and everything like that. They would send prayer. There's a story of a preacher who went to Kentucky. They said he was so ugly, everyone came to just look at him because he was so ugly. The place he went was called Rogue's Harbor. Why? Because there's such lawlessness there. He went and preached. And the power of the Spirit of God transformed that place left, right. There are so many stories that probably many of us aren't even aware. God's intervening and taking a place from an abyss of sin to bring it to a place of a great blessing and promise. But it just takes God's people seeking God's help for our nation. And if you are one of God's people here today, and I encourage you every day to be seeking him in prayer and asking him for on behalf of our leaders. The Bible tells us to do that, by the way. For our families, and for those that do not know him as their Savior, and that we can show the love of Christ to them. If you've never been saved, never been born again, can I encourage you today to respond to him? He loves you, he died for you because he wants a relationship with you. He desires that you and him be at peace. He desires that you and that one day that when you pass through death's door, that you will go to heaven. And I say that's the most important thing any person needs to know. If you don't know that today, please look me up after the service. I can offer myself or somebody else who's well qualified to show you from the Bible more clearly and answer your questions about the Lord. God's help for our nation. May we implore it these days. Not ignore it, not dismiss it, but seek it more heavily. For the future of our nation and the future of our children who will live here. Let's close with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you so much for this time we can study thy word. Lord, I just pray that the things that were spoken would touch our hearts. Lord, we desire for our nation here today just the opportunity, Lord, to beseech your throne for it. For none of us here today are perfect. But Lord, we do know that you are perfect. And Lord, you said, my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek thy face and turn from their wicked ways. And you'll hear from heaven. Forgive our sin. Lord, amen. God, we ask today, Lord God. We ask that your hand will be upon our government officials, that you help them lead in righteousness. Give them the courage and strength to do right. Give them even the understanding. We pray for our families, that the family unit would be strong. And I pray for churches, Father, that they would proclaim the gospel truth. And would not stand on righteousness, and be the pillar and ground of the truth. And you all would be. Father, thank you so much for this day that we can worship and reflect on your goodness for our nation. Yes, Lord.